Hi, I'm Anthony Troli. You may know me from the internet, or maybe real life, or possibly a past life, in which case I will not apologize for anything I may or may not have done. No matter which way you may know me, I have written a short story and recorded it in the comfort of my own closet, which is what you are about to hear if all goes as planned. It's from a series that I'm working on called Small Stories in Big Cities, which you will be able to find on my website, Amuseum.co, in the coming months. Why .co instead of .com? Funny you should ask, and I'll tell ya. The greedy son of a bitch who owned .com was not willing to give it up without a price. A price I was not willing to pay, as I'm very poor. Anyway, just follow us on Instagram. I should get back to the story. I picked Paris as our first destination, as this story pertains to events that actually unfolded in my own life, though those events have now been fictionalized. I truly hope that you enjoy it as much as I enjoyed writing it, though that may be difficult, as I was drinking a lot of whiskey while I was working on it. Anyway, I'm gonna stop talking and start telling this damned story. This is the Mime from Montmartre. Paris is no place for a boy with a broken heart. However, that is exactly where and what Ricky was. Please don't pity the poor bastard. In a way, the art student from the States did it to himself, for Ricky was a hopeless romantic. That said, he was an idiot. He should have never fallen for the C-minus student who he met when she chugged his bottom shelf champagne at a party until she puked. But c'est la vie. At the tender age of 20, it was his first real relationship, and first love is the worst love. Your friends and family hate her? Who cares? She's selfish? Sign me up! You've spent many months trying to please this person only to have lost your self-identity, self-worth, and self-respect? Well, who the hell needs those? You pass red flags faster than an alpine skier, yet at the end, you are somehow surprised when you realize you don't know dick about skiing, nor stopping on said skis, and you crash face first into a tree. The point is, Ricky should have had a hunch that when his college sweetheart said she wanted to study abroad in separate places, what she really wanted was to sleep with separate people, because that's exactly what she did. Let's reset our scene, shall we? There the idiot Ricky was, heartbroken in the City of Love, which was a well-earned title for the town of 2 million. It was as if the whole population of Paris were cute couples who conspired to shove their love right in Ricky's face. Where sweethearts strolled the streets arm in arm, Ricky walked alone. And where lovers locked lips, the kid cried. At this rate, Ricky wouldn't be surprised to find folks fucking right there in the streets. You could say that he would be better off back at his dorm, painting a picture or other lame-ass artsy-fartsy things. But Ricky was crippled by his breakup, and he had not the slightest bit of inspiration. All he wanted was to wander upon the one place in Paris where he wouldn't be reminded of the love he had lost, which seemed to be harder than finding a virgin in a whorehouse. Lucky for Ricky, he was new to the city. Hell, he had only been in France for 4 days and still had much more left to explore. After all, the young painter picked Paris as his education destination due to the romanticized roads of cobblestone and the laissez-faire lifestyle he so often saw in art pieces that portrayed the French Mecca. You could say it was cliché, and, well, you wouldn't be wrong. Ricky was a sappy little shit. The sad student moped his way over to Montmartre, a square where Vincent van Gogh and Pablo Picasso produced their early artwork. The young man thought Montmartre would be a breath of fresh air compared to the rest of the romantic city. It wasn't. The tourist trap consisted of caricaturists, street performers, and pickpockets preying on wide-eyed sightseers. The neighborhood was not nearly as enchanting as it was on the canvases of Claude Monet. It was rather goddamn ridiculous. But for the first time that afternoon, Ricky had not a thought about his ex due to Montmartre's bombardment of bullshit. He stopped at a souvenir shop where the gifts inside included keychains of the Eiffel Tower, tacky t-shirts, and other nonsensical knickknacks that your grandparents would purchase for you that you would pretend to appreciate. You know the ones. Surprising to Ricky, an unusual item caught his eye. It was a miniature music box in a barrel filled to the brim with them. Ricky picked up a cardboard-covered box and cranked the handle, only to hear the high-pitched notes of a tune he knew all too well. Lovey and Rose. This song was near and dear to Ricky's heart, for he and his ex would waltz to the Edith Piaf masterpiece in their dimly lit dorm rooms. "For fuck's sake!" Ricky exclaimed. The kid couldn't catch a damn break. Ricky stormed out of the store into the overpopulated Place de Tietz, looking oh so sad. If he was auditioning for a dog adoption advertisement, the lead role would go to Ricky. In the midst of Montmartre's madness, he saw someone who stuck out like a sore thumb. A mime. The silly street performer was as petite as he was peculiar, and incredibly creepy if we're calling a spade a spade. He wore white makeup that matched his white gloves, along with a white and black striped shirt, and, well, fuck it, folks, you know what mimes look like. He ran through his regular routine of pretending to stuff himself inside of a box, row an invisible boat, and walk against heavy wind on a day that didn't even have a breeze. He wrapped up his act to no applause and no audience whatsoever. Even in a plaza filled with people, nobody but Ricky seemed to even see the mime. He was not noticed, which was not so surprising. You see, the mime business is not what it once was. Nevertheless, the lack of support was quite alright for the mime who didn't rely on the riffraff of Montmartre to make himself happy. He was pleased with his performance, as it was for him and him alone, much like public masturbation. Ricky watched as the mime snagged a seat on a nearby bench to snack on a baguette and sip on a bottle of Bordeaux wine, which were both imaginary, of course. Ricky got a kick out of what he had witnessed, and although the broke boy was already riddled with college debt, he threw a few francs the mime's way anyhow. The boy began to drag himself back to his dorm, hoping he would be hit by a bus along the way, when the cheerful mime chased him down. The performer profusely shook Ricky's hand as if to say thanks for the change he had chucked at him. When the mime noticed the depressed expression right on Ricky's face, he held his hands up as if to ask what was wrong. But Ricky really didn't want to get into the nitty-gritty details of getting his ass dumped. The mime was not willing to let the boy go so soon, and eagerly invited Ricky to pop a squat on the bench. Ricky thought it through and considered his circumstances. He was lonely, to say the least, and didn't know a single soul in the city. The only other thing he had left to do that day was go back to his dorm and debate suicide. What the hell? Ricky said to himself as he sat down. The mime asked again what had Ricky down in the dumps, so he shared his sorrowful story.
Look, I'll get down to brass tacks. My lady left me. She was really something special, I swear. I saw myself spending the rest of my life with her. That wasn't until she told me that she cheated on me right before I boarded my plane to Paris. I mean, imagine that. I mean, 8 hours in the air thinking about the woman you love sucking another dude's dick? And what's even worse is knowing that she never truly cherished the love that we shared. The same love that she's been sharing with plenty of other people, apparently.
A tear rolled down Ricky's face as the kid caught his breath and wiped some snot from his nose. It was definitely disgusting, but we've all been there. The young man's melodramatic monologue had the mime clearly confused.
You don't speak an ounce of English, do you?
Ricky asked. The Frenchie didn't follow, so the tourist tried in terms that the mime would, without a doubt, understand.
Parlez-vous anglais?
The mime pointed to his mouth and shook his head as Ricky realized.
Right. You don't parlay at all.
The painter then put it into words the mime might understand, which were no words whatsoever. He used his hands to make the shape of his heart, then tore it apart into tiny pieces. This left the mime speechless, for lack of a better word. He immediately got what Ricky was going for, and really felt for the fella.
I must be the most pathetic piece of shit in Paris,
Ricky said to himself. And would you be willing to argue against him? No. There is absolutely no way you would. That was when the whimsical mime had an idea for old heartsick Rick. He put a frown upon his face, then hopped into a handstand.
Holy hell! Ricky hollered.
The mime pointed to Ricky as if to tell him to try for himself, but the pessimist proclaimed,
I'm an artist, not an acrobat.
The upside-down mime tried once more, when Ricky reiterated,
Really, I have absolutely no arm strength. Hence why I became a painter in the first place.
The mime felt frustrated as he forced Ricky to focus on his frown.
Oh!
Ricky now knew what the mime meant.
You want me to turn my frown upside down?
The mime excitedly stood up and nodded his head yes.
Well, why the hell didn't you just say so? Wait, don't answer that.
The white and black guy sat back on the bench. It was crystal clear that his one mission was to cheer up Ricky as a thanks for the francs.
You don't owe me a damn thing,
Ricky refused.
Besides, you must have more important mime things to do today.
The mime shook his head no, and Ricky knew business was a bit slow. The student shrugged his shoulders and asked,
Fine, How the hell do you want to help me out?
What Ricky saw next was nothing short of extraordinary. The mime reached down to the ground and pretended to pick up the pieces of the heart that Ricky had made with his hands. However, his torn apart heart, which was once imaginary, now took physical form. It was as if he could see exactly what the mime had imagined as he taped Ricky's ticker back to what it once was. Ricky felt fucking flabbergasted. It reminded him of when he ate one too many magic mushrooms and had mistaken his house cat for a tiger, which is a tale for another time. The mime put together a paper heart that looked very much like a Valentine. Then he handed it over to Ricky, who was still in shock, and rightfully so. If his jaw were to drop any lower, it would certainly smack him in the dick. The dumbfounded dweeb could not believe his eyes. But then again, he didn't want to.
Well, we tried, Ricky told the mime. Now if you'll excuse me, I'm gonna go fuck myself.
He tossed his heart into a trash can and went to walk back to campus, but the mime was not willing to let the boy with the broken heart go so soon. He stopped the student, but Ricky really did not want shit to do with the mime's magic.
You're a mime, Ricky said. What in the world could you offer other than a rope for me to hang myself from?
Though this question was rhetorical, the mime reached behind his back and handed Ricky a rope. The negative Nancy was none too pleased by this.
Is this a joke?
The mime laughed right in Ricky's face, then snatched the strand of rope. He grabbed Ricky by the wrist and tied one red balloon around it.
Yeah, gee, thanks,
the student said sarcastically.
You really know how to lift my spirits.
The witty mime waved au revoir to Ricky, who was kind of confused by this. Suddenly, his feet began to float a foot above the floor. Ricky looked up to see he was attached to not one, but 1,000 balloons. He was filled with fear as Ricky reached for a handrail nearby, grabbing it just in the nick of time before soaring off into the sky. Ricky looked back and belted out, "Help!" But the mime pretended to play stupid. Ricky could see that behind the mime's back, he held an extraordinarily large pair of scissors.
Come on, cut the crap!
But the mime wouldn't budge. Ricky's hand began to slip from the grip that he had on the rail.
Please, I'll do anything at all,
the boy begged. The mime made a frown, then pushed his sad expression into a smile. Ricky could see that the mime was unwilling to help unless the American adjusted his attitude.
If you give me the scissors, I'll be more positive,
he promised. The mime had Ricky's word, which would do. He snipped the strings right from Ricky's wrist, sending the bouquet of balloons straight into the sky as Ricky crashed down to the ground. He laid flat on the floor in great pain and protested.
I believe I've had my ass kicked enough emotionally. Do we really have to do it physically?
The mime picked up Ricky and put the fellow back on his feet. He straightened up the student and forced him to smile when Ricky remembered the rules.
Right. I have to try and cheer up.
The kid didn't know what to do, but many movies made it clear that the best medicine when one's lover has left him comes from behind a bar.
Maybe a bit of booze will help my broken heart. Do you happen to have any wine left over from lunch?
He asked. The mime handed an imaginary bottle of Bordeaux for him to have a sip, but Ricky downed the rest like a stingy dick. The mime was actually a little annoyed by this, as the make-believe bottle was especially expensive.
Great year,
Ricky uttered before burping. The student took a seat on the steps of the Sacré-Cœur, which is a Catholic cathedral and monument in Montmartre.
Now we wait for the wine to kick in and everything will be wonderful,
Ricky said hopefully. After what was maybe 1 minute, Ricky was hopeless. The alcohol had only heightened his emotions, and he began to bitch once more.
My girlfriend is gone,
he cried.
I don't want to live in a world without her. Finally, Romeo and Juliet's joint suicide makes sense.
The mime hushed the sorrowful student, but he was struggling.
I know you're trying to make me happy here, but I'm like a little boy who lost his balloon.
The mime pulled out another imaginary balloon, which Ricky slapped away.
You know what I mean, you fucking moron? I'm lonely. I lost my better half.
That was when Ricky had an idea. It was a drunk idea, but an idea nonetheless. And let's face it, we've all been there and we've all made mistakes, which is exactly what Ricky was about to do.
Maybe what I really need is a replacement. A new certain someone to make me happy. That's what I'll do. I'll fall for the first lady who looks at me the way my love once did.
Excuse me?
The somewhat wasted Ricky flipped around to find a lovely lady with an ambiguous accent. In that mere moment, the hopeless romantic Ricky's head was filled with 100 what-ifs. What if this was love at first sight? What if this whole breakup had led him to her? What if he was supposed to spend the rest of his life with her? What if his parents didn't like her like the last one? This all seemed so logical based on the romance novels Ricky had read and movie scenes he had seen. His hopes were as high as the Eiffel Tower itself.
Can you picture us?
She asked in broken English. And he certainly could. He saw them skipping along the River Seine, sipping champagne while listening to love songs in the Latin Quarter. He even imagined what their white wedding would look like in the Notre Dame, and plenty of other cute crap that would most likely make you puke.
Please?
She said.
You don't have to tell me twice, my love.
Ricky slyly replied. Then the stranger handed him a camera. Ricky was confused, but the woman quickly cleared that up as she wrapped her arms around a handsome man and posed. Ricky now knew what she wanted him to do. He snapped plenty of pictures of the pretty couple who passionately smooched in front of the Sacré-Cœur. They thanked the kid and walked away. The mime laughed at the tipsy Ricky, who was anything but amused.
For fuck's sake, fuck off. I'm very vulnerable, Ricky said. And to be fair, that was only one woman. There are many more in the City of Love, and I'm certain that I can find somebody to take the spot of my last lady,
Ricky reassured himself. Though he was pretty pathetic, he was positive.
What I need now is one hell of a wingman. What do you suggest I do? Be the strong, silent type?
Ricky enjoyed this joke much more than the mime, who now was the one who considered killing himself. The mime knew that this was nowhere near a fantastic theory. However, there comes a time in life when one must let their friend be, simply said, a shithead. This was one of those times. The mime reached behind his back and handed the moronic young man a bouquet of red roses. Ricky thought that the flowers were fantastic and would go on to give them to women around Montmartre. Well, he tried to at least. Only the mime and Ricky could see the roses as they were imaginary. This led to an awkward exchange with one woman who determined that Ricky was drunk, which she was right about. Regardless of the roses, the boy flirted with a baker, a barista, and a bartender, but they were not looking, not single, or not interested. He had exhausted all of his options, except for one. You probably have a hunch as to where this is heading.
I've got another idea,
Ricky exclaimed to the mime, who was rightfully worried.
A kid in college once said that the best way to get over somebody is to get under someone else. Though it sounded stupid at first, it makes much more sense to me now. That dumb boy was brilliant and incredibly talented. He could pop open a bottle of beer with his eyelid,
said the not-so-sober Ricky.
Some say you can't buy happiness, but those folks have probably never heard of prostitution.
The mime disapproved of this naughty notion, but Ricky made his way down a dark alley anyway. The mime tried to stop the stupid kid, but the nitwit pushed past him.
Don't get in my way,
Ricky replied. The mime reached for his rope and rapidly made a lasso. He twirled it above his head, then whipped it and wrangled Ricky, who fell on his face. The kid was pretty pissed as he quickly kicked the rope off of him.
Quit the shit. These bimbos will be the best thing for me.
Ricky walked down the alley only a few more feet when he found a group of young women who wore scandalous clothes and smoked cigarettes behind a building. Their colorful makeup was batshit crazy. It looked as if a crackhead finger painted on their faces. The dipshit did his best to speak French.
Bonjour,
Ricky said, then remembered he didn't know much more than that.
I don't mean to be a bother, but this is my first time paying people in your profession, so I'll be frank. I don't have many francs.
The women were confused, so the kid clarified.
I suppose I won't beat around the bush. I'm on a budget. So which one of you prostitutes is priced the lowest?
That was when one woman stood up that Ricky didn't find too attractive.
Honestly, I was hoping it wouldn't be you, but that'll do,
the student said. She then slapped the crap out of Ricky. The women were all appalled as they got up to go back inside the building. Ricky looked up to see the sign that swung above the door read, Cabaret. The dancers flicked their cigarettes and even spat on stupid Ricky, and rightfully so. He felt like such a fool as he faced the mime and asked,
Simple mistake, right?
The mime slapped Ricky as well, which was well deserved. Ricky and the mime made their way back to the main drag of Montmartre and sat on a bench as rain began to pour. It was safe to say that the desperate duo were shit out of luck.
You don't happen to have that rope still, do you?
The depressed Ricky asked. The mime reached behind his back and pulled out an umbrella that he popped open over Ricky's head. However, Ricky had lost every ounce of hope he had of being happy.
Stop!
Ricky shouted. He was done playing dumb games with the mime.
I do not want an imaginary umbrella. In fact, I no longer want to see what you see.
Suddenly, the umbrella vanished, as did the bench that the boy was seated on, and Ricky fell right on his ass. He looked over to see the mime squatting where the bench once was. Like much of the mime's magic, the bench was make-believe. Ricky even realized that the wine he had drank was also imaginary. Therefore, the dumbass was never drunk. So there he was, sober and soaking wet from rainfall. The mime covered the kid's head with his hands, but Ricky refused any more help as he pushed them away.
You have no chance of cheering me up,
Ricky pouted at his pal.
You're nothing more than a mime. I'd be better off with black tar heroin.
Ricky actually considered this for a couple seconds. The mime tried to get him off the ground, but Ricky sat still. He looked like a little kid who threw a fit at the supermarket when his mom would not purchase his favorite sugar-filled cereal.
Give it up, guy. You don't know the pain that I've been put through. I have lost the love of my life, and you'll never know what that's like.
Though the mime didn't know much of what Ricky had said for most of the day, he somehow understood this. And he quit his shtick. For the first time all afternoon, he was the one who frowned. The melancholy mime yanked one of his gloves from his hand to reveal a wedding ring around his finger.
Wow,
Ricky said, surprised.
Just another jackass rubbing his love right in my face.
The mime shook his head as Ricky misread what the ring represented. The mime put his hand in his pocket and pulled out a rather small object, then tossed it to Ricky. It was a woman's wedding ring, and Ricky assumed it must belong to the mime's ex-wife.
Did your lady leave you too?
Ricky wondered. The mime nodded his head yes, and Ricky made many more assumptions.
Did she meet another man? Did she fuck your friend? Did she blow her boss?
These ridiculous conclusions only upset his French friend, who shook his head. The mime couldn't help but cry. The tears smeared the white makeup on his face as Ricky put two and two together.
She died, didn't she?
The mime did not say a word, obviously. However, Ricky knew that this was true, but before he could feel the weight of the widowed mime's words, or lack thereof, a pickpocket ripped the mime's wife's wedding ring right out of Ricky's hand and sprinted down the street. Ricky rapidly raced after the thief, who bolted through the busy boulevards of Montmartre. He could see that the thief was a kid no older than 8 years old. The mime could barely keep up with the very quick Ricky. He was out of shape, as miming isn't exactly a workout. The pickpocket had a pretty decent lead on Ricky, who pushed past a ton of tourists and artists alike. Ricky was not willing to let that little shit get away with the wedding ring. The miniature thief made his way into a metro station and reached a staircase that went deep down underground. Ricky was so close to catching the thief when the sly kid slid down the staircase's steep handrail at what seemed like 60 miles per hour. Ricky was about to do the same, but he was a wuss who wimped out. Ricky ran down the stairs, and when he reached the bottom, he saw the little pickpocket limbo right under the turnstile. Ricky was about to pounce over the pay station himself when he was stopped by a security guard. Ricky reached into his pocket to pay, but the broke boy didn't have a dime. The mime finally caught up to Ricky.
He has money,
Ricky said as the mime quickly whipped out a wad of cash.
His is no good here, shouted the security guard.
Ricky looked over and realized that the mime held make-believe money.
Damn it! This is no time for miming!
Ricky yelled. The mime then remembered the few francs that Ricky had given him earlier in the day, and he paid for the two to get through the turnstile. The pals were now on the prowl as they entered the platform. Ricky and the mime looked every which way for the thief, but the station was hustling and bustling. The platform was filled with French folks who hopped on and off of metro cars. The place was a zoo. If that zoo was one where all the animals had escaped their cages and people were running for their goddamn lives. The two had not a clue where the pickpocket was, so on a whim, they boarded a metro car that was close by. Ricky scanned over the subway, when suddenly, he ran into the back of a petite passenger.
Sorry, sir,
Ricky said. Then the rider turned around to reveal it was the thief! Ricky reached out to grab him, but the kid slipped from his grip. Ricky chased the pickpocket through the packed car, squeezing past Parisians. The little robber reached the doors at the other end of the car and hopped off the train. Ricky went to exit as well, but he was blocked by many musicians who were boarding. Ricky couldn't get by the group and their ridiculously large instruments. The door shut on the student's face, and he could only watch out the window as the baby bandit got away with the mime's late wife's wedding ring. The subway started up. Ricky turned to the mime, who saw what had happened. He was heartbroken as he took a seat between two strangers. Ricky felt awful.
"This is all my fault,"
he said.
"I've been nothing but a selfish son of a bitch, complaining as if I'm the only one who's ever had his heart broken. Meanwhile, you're the widowed one, and now your wife's wedding ring is long gone."
The mime didn't have much to say. Actually, he didn't have anything at all. The tables had turned. Ricky wanted nothing more for his newfound friend than to see him happy again. Ricky made a frown, then flipped it into a smile for the mime, but he shook his head. He did not want Ricky to try to cheer him up.
"Well, if I can't make you happy, who the hell will?"
Ricky asked. The mime raised his hand and pointed at the pane of the subway window. Ricky saw the reflection as the mime faked a smile to himself. Only he could make himself happy. The band that boarded the metro began to busk in the packed subway. Of course, out of all the songs they could have sang, they played the one that would add salt to Ricky's wound. Lovey and Rose.
"This city sure sucks,"
Ricky said to himself as he recalled waltzing with his ex to this tune. He looked to the mime, whose misery was even worse.
"What's wrong now?"
he asked, and the mime pointed to his ring. Ricky assumed that this must have been a song played on the day of his wedding. The friends were figuratively, and literally, at their lowest in the metro. As Ricky muttered,
"We must be the most miserable men in all of Montmartre."
Ricky looked at his reflection in the window and saw himself sitting there, sulking on the subway. He had never seen himself cry. He looked like a pathetic, poorly painted portrait. It was as if his face was melting, much like the clocks of the classic Dali painting. Ricky could see that he looked so stupid, and actually laughed at his lousy-ass face. That was when he saw himself smile for the first time in 4 days, and in that mere moment, Ricky remembered what life was like before he had even met the gal who would go on to break his heart. He was simply Ricky, a pretentious piece of shit painter, but a pleasant one at that. He never once sat on his ass and waited for inspiration to strike. Instead, he had to go find it himself. Ricky now realized that he had spent his whole day relying on the mime, wine, and the people of Paris to put his heart back together. He knew now that if he wanted to be happy once more, he had to do it all on his own like he once did. Though he was still upset, Ricky had no choice but to physically force himself to be happy. "Get up," the student said to the mime as he hopped up to his feet. The mime was quite content mourning in the memories of his wedding as the three-piece band performed La Vie en Rose.
"Come on,"
the kid insisted. But the mime made no moves. Instead, Ricky reached out to an elderly woman who sat next to the mime. He held out his hand and offered the lady a dance. Though at first she was surprised, she was 72 and didn't have shit to lose, so she began to slow dance with Ricky. He looked back at the mime, who thought Ricky might have lost his marbles, and was still unwilling to join in. Ricky passed the lady to his left to a construction worker who began to waltz with her. The student moved on and got another stranger to sway with him, then another, and another after that. Slowly but surely, Ricky turned the subway into a full-blown ballroom. Ricky returned to the mime, who was the last man in the metro not dancing. He held out his hand for his new friend once more, and this time the mime grabbed it. There the two were, dancing to a tune that once ripped their hearts apart. They swayed back and forth, and began to laugh at the ridiculous situation that they were in. It was pure bliss to the boys. The song came to an end, and the subway came to a stop. The Parisians pushed their way off the metro, and in the madness, the mime and Ricky were separated. Ricky looked for his French friend on the platform, but he was nowhere to be found. Ricky rushed up the stairs of the station and was back on the street. You'd think that finding a mime would be easy, but you would be wrong. It was as if Ricky was playing Where's Waldo in real life, but his buddy was long gone. The American was all on his own once again. Only now, Ricky was not lonely. The sky was saturated in a deep pink as the sun had set over Paris. It was as pretty as a postcard. Ricky took this in for a minute or two when something caught his attention. The kid approached a nearby kiosk that sold keychains and other shitty souvenirs, including miniature music boxes. Ricky cranked the handle of one and was not so surprised when he heard the same sentimental song play yet again. However, the song suddenly had new meaning. Ricky didn't recall the dumbass who had dumped him, and he no longer wanted to heave himself off the Eiffel Tower. Instead, Ricky smiled and remembered dancing with a mime in the metro of Paris only moments ago. He purchased the miniature music box and went on his way. Ricky would walk home that night and pass plenty of people in love. Though this time, he didn't mind these kissing dipshits. Without the 10 million tears in his eyes that he had earlier, Ricky saw the city so differently. Where lovers slow danced in the streets, he saw the red sails of the Moulin Rouge, and where people padlocked their love away on a bridge, the guy saw the glow of the Eiffel Tower from afar. He made sure to stop by the backstage of the cabaret to say sorry to the dancers who he had mistaken for hookers. They accepted his apology, and the gals even gave him a free ticket to their show. It was wonderful. Although Ricky sadly never saw the mime ever again, even when he revisited Montmartre, he would always recall the day he had with his fantastical friend. Whenever he got sad, mad, or lonely, he played La Vie en Rose on his miniature music box. He remembered the moment he had to choose to be happy, and in turn, turn his sadness into something special. Ricky went on to paint the passengers dancing and swaying in the subway, and he actually sold it for enough francs to supply him with cheap champagne for the rest of his trip. With all of this, he would make the most of his life while in the City of Lights. After all, Paris is a perfect place for a painter, especially a sappy little shit like Ricky. Thank you all so much for listening to my short story, The Mime of Montmartre. I'm sure you had better things to do, but you didn't do those things, and I couldn't thank you anymore. Be sure to follow Amuseum.co on Instagram for future projects, including more short stories such as this one, and plenty of other comedic art projects. If you enjoyed this story, I hope that you would share it with a friend. Thank you again so much for listening. I'm Anthony Troli, and have a lovely rest of your day.